Okay.
Can we start?
One second. Yes, please go ahead.
Okay.
Welcome you all. This is the sixth webinar from Indian Arthroscopy Society. Today our topic is the meniscal repair. And this webinar is organized by Ranjit Panigrahi, who is a renowned arthroscopic surgeon in Odisha. And he is masterminded by our beloved friend and who is currently the vice president of our association, Dr. Sachin Tapasi. And other faculties are there, Dr. Anupama Patil. I welcome you.
Thank you.
And Dr. IPS Oberoi, who is currently our president of the association. And also my dear friend Gopi Nath is there. He is from Kerala. And the other faculties are there, like Tanmay is there. He is from Indore. Dr. Sridhar is there. So I welcome you all. And now the meeting will be moderated by Sachin and Ranjit. So first I will request Dr. Anupama Patil Dr. Sachin to go ahead for some words, and then he will initiate the meeting. Thank you.
Thank you so much, friends, and welcome to this first session, first in three of meniscus repair. And Ranjit thought that it would be nice that we go through this whole series of meniscus repair in three steps. First, we do the basics. In the second webinar, we'll be looking at more advanced techniques or repairing more complex tears. And lastly, in the third webinar, we'd love to go to a case-based discussion where all of us can learn from each other's experiences. So why should we learn to repair the meniscus? It's not essentially a fashionable trend to do that, but one has to understand that the meniscus does serve very important biomechanical functions. It carries about 50% load on the medial side and almost 70% load on the lateral side. And Dr. IPS Oberoi will be discussing the various biomechanical functions in details in his next presentation, which is to come. We all need to understand that when we look at our ACL injured knee, almost a third of them will have a medial meniscus tear and about 45% are going to have a lateral meniscus tear. So it's important that we pick up on our radiology colleague cues, who will guide us, that these are the ACL injuries or these are the injured knees that have torn menisci that need to be sorted out. Dr. Oberoi will again discuss why is it important to repair the meniscus and the various principles of doing a meniscus repair. If you inadvertently or unnecessarily remove the meniscus, it is definitely going to lead to osteoarthritis. And this has been very well described in literature, that the amount of meniscus you remove is going to lead to the degree of osteoarthritis in the knee joint. So we're going to kick off this first of three webinars on meniscus tears. And we're going to come back to you with messages which state that it is important to save meniscal tissue to restore normal biomechanics and save the knee. So with this, I'm going to hand over the proceedings to Dr. Anupama Patil, who is a trained musculoskeletal radiologist from Pune, and she is well known through the national and the international circuit with her various teachings on looking at various aspects of musculoskeletal imaging. The main points that I think we'd like to take home from her talk would be, which are the tears that we should be repairing? What are the cues that we should be picking up? And also we'll learn from her as to how we can look at our meniscal repairs and realize whether they're healed or not. Over to you, Dr. Anupama Patil.
Thank you, Sachin. Good evening, everyone. So how do I image the meniscus? Okay. So I'm fortunate, I work on a 3 Tesla scanner. I have a dedicated knee coil. And when you have these two things, you can get really good high resolution images of the knee. All joints have to be screened in all three planes, sagittal, coronal, and axial. In addition, when we're looking at the meniscus, I like to do this volumetric acquisition with thin axial reformats, which go through the plane of the meniscus, and I'll explain that later. When I'm looking at...
Ma'am, we need to share the screen, please.
Sachin, if you feel that in between the two talks, one talks, you can take one or two questions, you can take that in between the sharing the screen. Or else, you whatever you feel like, you can go ahead.
Press okay. the green button in the center.
One minute.
There's a green button which says share screen. So once you click on that, you'll be able to share it. So I think, while she's getting her screen up, it's important that, we look at this aspect. And very quickly across the panel, I'll start with you, Rajiv, then go to Tanmay, and then Dr. Gopinath. So Rajiv, since when have you started doing meniscal repairs? Very quick answers. Just give me 1 year, 10 years, whatever the answer would be.
Last 2 years.
2 years. 1 second. Sandeep, please call Dr. Anupama Patil and tell her how to do screen share.
Yes, sir.
So last 2 years, you're doing meniscus repairs. Tanmay, how long have you been doing meniscal repairs now? No, you need to unmute. Unmute yourself. Tanmay, unmute yourself.
2.5 years.
2.5 years. Dr. Gopinath?
Yeah.
5, 6 years.
5, 6 years. Sridhar?
Yeah, 2 years, sir. Two and a half.
2 years. Ranjit, how long have you been doing meniscus repairs? Ranjit, unmute.
3 years.
Three years now.
Ma'am,
Samantha, sir? Samantha, sir, how long have you been doing meniscal repairs? Unmute yourself.
Doing meniscal repair when only this specialized cannula were there only that time. So it is probably like 7-8 years more than.
And what about your IPS?
Yeah, around 6-7 years, but off late numbers have increased. Before, very, very selective.
Okay. So I think that's an important thing that we all, are looking at essentially, is that it's been meniscus repairs has been around for quite a while now. And I think it's really important that we understand all the various techniques of meniscus repair and look at essentially which meniscus tears that we really need to repair and how. So what I'll do is that where is Sandeep? Sandeep, is sharing screen becoming a problem? If that is the question, then why don't we have IPS go on with his presentation and discuss about principles of meniscus repair? And then we'll come back to Dr. Patil's presentation. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay, so I can start the presentation.
IPS, you can go ahead.
Yeah, I can start then. It makes sense then. Okay, I think it's important that... What we are going to talk about is meniscus repair. And as Sachin rightly said... meniscus repair is something which is now very getting much more popular and common. It's important to save a meniscus. Conventional literature shows that if a partial meniscectomy is done, the contact area decreases by around 10%, but the stresses onto the joint increases by around 65%. It becomes much more if a complete meniscectomy is done. Contact area decreases by 50 to 75%. But the peak stresses increases by 235%, which means that arthritis is bound to happen if you don't preserve the meniscus. Now, what is important is that you have to choose the right patient to do a meniscus repair. It's a technically difficult surgery. Your indication of meniscus repair has to be absolutely right. And you should not get bought out by industry because a lot of things are happening industry driven these days. And to just blindly follow an industry and go and start doing meniscus repair right, left, and center is something which is not a good way to go about it. I'll enumerate certain points when you see a patient of a meniscus tear and OPD, and then choose the right patient to do a meniscus repair. There are around 8 to 9 factors which you should consider when you see a patient of meniscus tear in your OPD. Number one, what is the region of meniscus tear, which means whether it is in a red-red zone, a red-white zone, or a white-white zone. Where exactly is the meniscus tear located and should it be operated or not? Number two, age of the patient. Is that a criteria? If you get a 20-year-old or a 40-year-old or a 50-year-old, which is the patient you should actually go ahead and choose to do a meniscus repair? Number three is type of tear, depending upon number of configuration of tears, which could be a bucket handle tear, a horizontal tear, a longitudinal or an oblique tear. What are the meniscus tears where you are sure that results are much better? Would you choose a patient to do a meniscus repair? Chronicity of tear is also important. There are tears which come around 2 months, 3 months, 6 months later on. Should you repair them? What does literature say about it? And how much can you promise your patients in such kind of tears? Medial or lateral, is there a difference or results between a medial meniscus tear or a lateral meniscus tear? If so, why? And which patient should you choose to do it? Is limb alignment important? What does literature says? A lot of Indian patients already have a varus in their knee. Should you keep on correcting all the varuses along with a meniscus repair? If a meniscus repair tear is associated with an ACL reconstruction, what should be your criteria? Should you do either a simple meniscus repair or combine it with an ACL reconstruction at a single go or at stage manner? And finally, looking for hidden lesions, ramp and root tears. So these eight criteria are important to decide what is the right patient where you should do a meniscus repair. Coming to the first point, the region of meniscus tear. I think literature is very, very clear about it. This is classical work in 1983 where meniscus vascularity was described, and perimeniscal capsular plexus shows that the periphery of meniscus is very vascular. The periphery then starts to go, the blood supply starts to go towards the central. In the medial meniscus, it travels to around 30%. In lateral meniscus, also around 10 to 25%. And this is a zone which comes at what is called as a red and white zone. But then beyond that area, it's usually avascular. It is called a white zone. So once there is hardly any blood supply, the healing rate is much more poorer. If the blood supply is good, the healing rate is much higher. And that is how literature also tells us that clinical outcomes of these kind of repairs are actually much better in a red and a red white zone. And even in these areas, try to use inside out meniscus repair techniques to repair it. The results of these two zones are good. So if you have a patient which has got a tear which is in these zones, you are confident that results would be good. Also, it is important that this is an important article which shows about follow-up of around 6 years of a meniscus repair. And it says that if the tear width, the rim is between 6 millimeters from the synovial junction, around 5 to 6 millimeters. And you can see with the probe how far away is your meniscus tear from the synovial meniscal junction. And it says if the tear is around 6 millimeters from that junction, it is still vascular, results are still pretty good. Another article which shows that even if the tears which are more central, they heal, they are much more prone to re-ruptures than a tear which is actually quite away. So the conclusion in an area where meniscus tears are going to heal are essentially peripheral meniscal tears, which are between 5 to 7 millimeters from the meniscocapsular junction. These are the cases which you should go and promise that the healing would happen, and you should choose these patients to repair. If the tear is coming more central, probably your results will be guarded. The rate, if at all a bit of healing does happen, re-ruptures are high, and you have to discuss that with the patient. Number two comes the age of the patient. Younger the patient, normally we feel that the healing would happen fast. Literature evaluated patients which were less than 40 years and also patients which were more than 40 years. What was surprising to all of us is that the results of patients which are less than 40 years and which are more than 40 years, the results are actually same, which means we should not deny a meniscus repair in a patient where meniscus is reducible, it is vascular, even if the patient is more than 40 years of age. The failure rate of both these cases is just around 5% in around 10 years' time. So meniscus does heal even in an old senior individual as well. And this article confirms that. Another article also, which comes in Arthroscopy Journal, and it also tells that it is the location and the type of meniscus tear which is important, rather than the age of patient, that determines the potential for a successful repair. So you should not deny a meniscus repair on the age criteria. Yet, though younger the patient, the healing is faster, but even if the patient is older than 40, the healing rates are as compared to younger patients as well. Number three criteria of doing a meniscus repair is choosing the type of meniscus tear. And I think this is critically very, very important. Out of all the three, region and tear type is very, very important. Now, type of tear, we all know, are different type of tears. Some tears are very clean tears. You can identify this is just a horizontal tear. This is a bucket handle tear. Some tears are radial, oblique tears. But then there are small tears like flap tears or cleavage tears. But then there are combinations of tear, especially if the chronic meniscus tear is there. They usually come in different combinations. What is important is to realize that upper three part of tears usually have large material of meniscus tissue. Usually horizontal meniscus tissue tear is peripheral tear. It has got a large material of meniscus tissue. Bucket handle has large material of meniscus tissue, which is torn. Radial tear, if you just excise a radial tear, you lose a lot amount of tissue. So probably these three are the meniscus tears which need more care. And these are the tears where probably surgery repair is going to help the patient. Smaller tears like flap tears or cleavage tears can easily be divided or neglected. And if it is a complex tear, don't try to repair it because the results of repair in a complex tear is not so great. Now, this is an article which is very interesting, and it where they did a clinical and a second look arthroscopy of the meniscus tears. And what they did is they classified the meniscus tear into simple tears. Among simple, they saw the results in simple longitudinal and bucket handle tears. Almost all of these meniscus healed. Simple longitudinal meniscus, around 91% healed completely and 8% incompletely healed, but healing was pretty high. Even in a bucket handle tear, the healing rate was between 90 and 95%. But as the meniscus becomes more complex, like a double longitudinal tear, the healing rate falls from 91% to 66%. And failure rate increases to around 10% or so. Also, if it is a combined tear, the meniscus healing is very, very low. So simpler the tear, the results are better. So if you have a simple longitudinal tear or a bucket handle tear, the results and the outcomes are much more better than a double longitudinal tear or a combination tear or a complex tear. There's another article which shows that complex tear, even if it is in a red white zone, are bad. You don't repair them because the results are bad. But if you have a simple longitudinal tear or a bucket handle tear in this red or a red white zone, the healing rate is pretty high. It's important when you see a patient with a bucket handle tear that the tear should be reducible. There are chronic tears which are held in the intercondylar notch. They are not reducible. And by reducing them forcefully and try to repair them, they are going to fail because these meniscus would have tendency to come back into the intercondylar notch. Also, extent of tear is important. Sometimes the bucket handle tear is a small bucket handle. Don't be overzealous to actually repair a small bucket handle tear because you don't lose quite a bit of meniscus tissue. It's also important that behind a meniscus tear, you should evaluate how is the quality of tissue behind a bucket handle. Because sometimes you would be surprised to find that you have removed a part of meniscus tear. Behind there was a cleavage component and a complex cleavage component. So these patients are not going to be happy after meniscus repair. So just finding a bucket handle tear does not mean you should repair every bucket handle. A bucket handle should be reducible. A bucket handle should have enough material to repair. And bucket handle should have less damage in the peripheral part, which there should be hardly any cleavage component or a very minimal cleavage component. And these patients would then become better after the repair. These small tears like cleavage tears and flap tears, you need not repair them. You can just maybe excise them, trim superior or inferior flap of the cleavage tear. Overzealous attempt, instrument driven by industry to repair even cleavage tears, stitching up and down, even flap tears, putting it back, using some kind of bioabsorbable implants are not good. They cause a lot of friction because they are usually in the center of the joint and they cause arthritis to happen. So I think we have to really choose the patient wisely before we can subject them for a repair. Reoperation rate after radial tears are also not so great. But radial tear, because the meniscus tissue material is quite a lot, and you just can't excise a radial tear completely. It is better to repair the peripheral part by your meniscal suturing devices, but the central part may be essentially balance and trim. So you do a combination of some kind of a partial meniscectomy with a peripheral meniscus repair in a radial tear component. So looking into the configuration of meniscus tear, it is important that we realize that radial tears, bucket handle tears, and longitudinal tears are the three type of tears where you should try and attempt a repair. Cleavage tears, flap tears, and complex tears, don't be overzealous. Never try to overdo it, because complication rates are much more higher. The fourth thing which comes to our mind is chronicity of tear. A lot of our patients come older after injury, couple of months later. So what does literature say about chronicity of tear? If the tear is in red or a red white zone, even if the patient is coming more than 3 months later, the healing rate is around 85%. And you can actually quote these numbers to the patient that, yeah, there is no 100% sure that you are going to repair, heal, you are coming pretty late, but you still, there is chance of 85%. So if your patient comes around 3 months and it is in a zone which is red or a red white zone, it is a reducible tear, and you think you can take an attempt to repair it, just the duration should not stop you from repairing it. Even if it is 3-4 months down the line, you can still attempt to repair it, and you would be surprised these patients heal pretty well. And that's another article which tells that even a chronic bucket handle tear, if it is reducible, if you are able to put it back in the place from where it came, the results even at 5 years is absolutely good and they heal well. Again, couple of more articles which shows that the healing rate is up to 80, 84, 85% in patients even coming after 3-4 months of injury. So don't refuse a patient that you have got a chronic tear, we should not repair it. Even chronicity, chronic tears, if reducible, you can do it. And there are surgical techniques, and I'm sure Sachin is going to talk about refining and debridement and surgical technique to escalate the healing even in chronic tears. Now, medial or a lateral meniscus tear, is there a difference? Well, articles are very, very clear. Medial meniscal tear, the success rate is much less than lateral meniscus tear. The repair rate, the healing is around 72% for medial meniscal tears, and isolated lateral meniscus is around 85%. Long-term reoperation rate after medial meniscus tear is much higher as compared to lateral meniscus tear. So if you have a patient who has got a medial meniscus and a lateral meniscus tear, and given a choice which one you want to operate, if you have to choose one, lateral takes priority, because lateral is more important. Lateral healing rate is much higher. Reoperation rate after a lateral meniscus repair is much less as compared to medial meniscus. There are many factors, but given a choice between medial and lateral meniscus, take some time, spend more time on lateral meniscus repair than medial meniscus repair. Medial meniscus, because it's tightly anchored to the tibial plateau, the biomechanical loads are pretty high. The failure rates are also high. And also, even if you combine it with the ACL reconstruction, wherever it is indicated, and if you still have a residual laxity after the ACL reconstruction, the stresses on the medial meniscus becomes pretty high and it's going to fail anyway. So medial meniscus, you have to be a bit cautious. Lateral meniscus, always take a chance and try to repair it. Coming to limb alignment, I think don't be overzealous. Don't try to correct all the varus knees. We do have a lot of varus knees in India. But if these patients have a varus thirst, these are the patients where you must do a corrective osteotomy. There are some patients where there is an abnormal tibial slope as well. And if you have an abnormal tibial slope, it causes a lot of pressure on the posterior horn of the meniscus. So if there is a varus thirst, if the patient walks with a varus thirst, and on an X-ray you find there is significant varus, and also there is alteration of soap in addition to meniscus repair, you should try and do meniscus varus deformity correction. But you have to be cautious. Results are not so great. You have to choose a patient where there is a meniscal tear with a significant varus deformity, with a dynamic varus thrust, where you can actually repair and correct it. If there is an associated ACL reconstruction, it is recommended that you do both the procedures at the same time. Stabilization of anterior cruciate ligament provides much better environment for meniscus to heal. Also, the marrow elements like the blood and the hematoma, which is from the ACL reconstruction, induces healing in the meniscus tear. And long-term follow-ups up to 12 years of combined ACL reconstruction and meniscus repair are very encouraging. So whenever you have an ACL tear where meniscus repair is repairable, you should do both the procedures at the same time. Healing is much faster, results are much, much better about it. But word of caution is there that you should reconstruct your ACL nicely. If you reconstruct your ACL poorly, it actually impairs the healing of the meniscus which you have repaired, and it will ultimately fail. So you should do a very good ACL reconstruction if you're doing a meniscus repair simultaneously. The clinical success is around 96%, which is pretty high. Simple, pure meniscus repairs, the results are around 90 to 92%, but combined with ACL reconstruction, the clinical success records become 96, 97%. So definitely, if you're doing an ACL reconstruction, you're making knee more stable. The hematoma itself is going to become vascular and going to help. And finally, there are lesions of meniscus which should not be neglected. These are patients where repairs are going to help. And these are called ramp lesions and root lesions. That's a ramp lesion on the left side, which is a meniscosynovial separation in the back of the knee. It's a vascular area. Attempt should be there to repair it if it is a bigger tear. And the other one on the right side is a root tear. Root is the meniscus becomes pretty unstable. And if the root is torn, then the hoop stresses are gone and meniscus becomes unstable. To see these tears, you have to really go into the intercondylar notch view. So that's the intercondylar notch view from where we go and see a ramp tear. That's in the back of the knee. That's the peripheral capsular region of the medial meniscus on the ramp tear. And the other one is a root tear, which is on the medial meniscus. And this medial meniscus root tear is basically you have to remove fat from the PCL. And then as you go between the PCL and the medial femoral condyle, you identify a root tear. So ramp and root tears are important. Biomechanically, they are very, very important. And if arthritic component is not too much in the joint, you should always try to repair both of these lesions. Biomechanical study shows that if you don't repair a meniscus root tear, it behaves as if you have done a total meniscectomy. The hoop stresses will cause the joint to become arthritic in 1 to 2 years' time. So every attempt should be made to do a meniscus root repair. And root repair have got good results, especially root avulsions. They got good results and you are able to put it back and they heal pretty well. The review of literature shows that root tears heal by up to 96%. So if you are doing an MRI and an MRI, you are able to diagnose either a ramp tear or a root tear, you should try and repair it. So concluding remarks, to choose the right patient to do a meniscus repair, the region is very important. It should be a vascular area between 6 to 7 millimeters from the meniscocapsular junction. In a red zone and a red-white zone, you should attempt to do a repair, but never be overzealous to do it in a white-white zone. Age is not very important. Younger patients, 20, 30, 40, are equally good as compared to patients which are 45, 50, or 60 if they are not arthritic. So age is not very, very important. Type of tear is important. Longitudinal tears, reducible, simple bucket handle tears, and radial tears, every attempt should be made to repair them. Chronicity is not important. There are tears which come 3 months, 4 months, 5 months down the line. If they are reducible and there is good amount of tissue material, you should try and attempt and repair it. Lateral meniscus fares well, better. So given a choice, if you are short of time and short of implants, spend more implants on the lateral meniscus than the medial meniscus. Limb alignment is not very important, except in cases where there is varus, which is significant, or the patient walks with a varus thirst. And in these patients, it must be treated. If the ACL is torn along with the meniscus repair, it definitely improves the results dramatically. And hidden lesions of ramp and root are very, very important. They must be diagnosed and the repair is necessary. Thank you very much.
Thanks, IPS, for an excellent talk. Now, my appeal to the viewers, you keep on posting the questions in the YouTube chat box.
Ma'am, or you can send start sharing your screen, ma'am.
Yeah, in the chat box, or you can send the messages. We'll take all the viewers' question at the end of all the presentation. To IPS, one condition in which a patient comes, a very young athlete of 20 years age, with a bucket handle tear of the lateral meniscus. And he has a very important game to play, the career deciding match shortly. And he is not very convinced about your post-op restriction of the meniscal repair. And he is not convinced about the failure rate. But he is insisting on a meniscectomy. So how you take these kind of patients?
Right.
How you convince them?
No, Ranjit, I think it's important for us to tell them the short-term gains and the long-term gains. If he wants to make his athletic career short, he may as well opt for getting a meniscectomy done. But if he wants his athletic career to be in full bloom and full, he must ask us to attempt a meniscus repair. I understand rehabilitation is totally different. Meniscus repair.
It's not highlighted. What happened to it?
But I think it is important for us to be honest with the patient and convince them. A game or two, he may leave it. But long term, his knee arthritis is going to happen if we don't repair the meniscus.
Right,
so injured knee, yes, bucket handled here, young athlete, always try to repair it. It is a repairable kind of scenario, probably, as you said, and it should be attempt to repair. So he must understand how his knee is going to behave if we don't, he doesn't follow the regime.
Sandeep, madam is ready with the presentation, I think. Sandeep?
Yeah, ma'am is ready with the presentation.
Sandeep?
Just 2 minutes.
Yeah, one more question to Dr. IPS.
Yeah, Pranjit.
In acute ACL tear with a locked bucket handle tear, day one, the patient comes with a locked knee. What you will do? You will do a same stage procedure of both or a staggered procedure?
No, I would do both at the same stage. Lot of literature are coming. ACL acute repairs are now getting in vogue back. And I think you have a locked meniscus. When you have a locked meniscus, the best results are to reduce the locked meniscus tear. If it is repairable, you would go ahead and repair it. If it is a small fragment which is locking and you have an ACL tear, you may just unlock the meniscus, remove that small fragment, do an ACL as an elective surgery. Repairing the meniscus on day one, I would actually do an ACL reconstruction on day one. So it depends upon the type of meniscus tear. If it is a small meniscus tear which is coming in between, I may actually go and do just a small meniscus excision, unlock the knee and leave it. But if it is a big fragment of a bucket handle, medial or a lateral meniscus tear, I would unlock the knee, repair the meniscus and do an ACL at the same setting. The results are really very, very good. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Saman sir,
yes.
your take on this, you will go for a single stage or staggered manner because it's a 1 day old injury with a locked knee with ACL tear and bucket handle tear.
Yes, I completely agree with IPS that if it is a big fragment which is coming inside and your knee is completely locked and you cannot make it unlock, then in MR you see it's a big one, then you have to go ahead with the both and single go because you cannot leave aside that single because it will not going to help the patient. It will just go on abrading the cartilage. The tear pattern will increase. The patient will be in pain. You will never settle down. So go ahead with the one go. This is probably the one indication where I will go ahead with the acute setting. Otherwise, I will go. I told the last day that I will go ahead with 2 weeks, 3 weeks time. This is probably one indication where I will be very aggressive to go with two in one go.
Yeah.
IPS agreed?
Yeah, agreed. That is what I said. I mean, if it's a big distance here,
I think ma'am is ready with the presentation.
Yeah, ma'am is ready. Yes.
Yeah.
Ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, welcome.
I apologize for the whole confusion. Okay. So how does one look for meniscal tears? Dr. IPS actually very nicely elucidated all the clinical criteria. And there are some radiological criteria and we will see those now. This is the protocol that I follow for knee meniscus. I'm fortunate. I work on a 3 Tesla scanner and I have a dedicated knee coil. So I can really get very good images of menisci. All joints are imaged in all three planes, sagittal, coronal, and axial. And in fact, for the meniscus, we take this volumetric sequence and thin axial reformats through the plane of the menisci. And I will discuss that a little later. I use contrast imaging with indirect MR arthrograms when I'm looking for meniscal repairs. And finally, cartilage mapping I use in young people. So what is the role of the radiologist? First of all, when we see signals on the MRI to determine whether that signal is a tear truly, or is it just degeneration, or is there a combination of both things? Secondly, to provide morphology, as Dr. IPS just said, if we know the location of the tear, we know the exact extent, its distance from the periphery and from the inner margin, that is which zone that tear extends through. If we know whether the root is also involved, it really is very helpful in deciding repairability of that meniscus. Also, displacement of torn meniscal tissue. If it's gone and gotten lodged somewhere in one of the recesses, it's very useful to know that prior to your arthroscopy. And finally, but not least important, is the status of the underlying cartilage and whether, in fact, osteoarthritis has already set in. Okay, so this is the normal anatomy of the meniscus, and we only look at these three things. Okay, you look for the shape of the meniscus. The meniscus is usually seen as a triangular structure, posterior horn and anterior horn. The body of the meniscus, nice smooth margins. It should have an apex which is nicely pointed. And on all pulse sequences, T1, T2, whatever sequence you look at, the inside of that meniscus, the signal is always black, unless there is pathology in it. Size of the meniscus, we'll discuss a little later when we come to the post-op meniscus. Now, often radiologists will report meniscal signal as either grade 1, 2, or 3. Let us understand what these grades are. So grade 1 signal is that which is entirely confined to the substance of the meniscus. It doesn't go to the periphery. It doesn't go to the articular margin. It doesn't go to the inner margin. And these are usually either degenerative or in a young patient, just after trauma, sometimes you can get post-traumatic edema. A grade 2 signal is one that extends to the capsular margin. It doesn't extend to the articular surfaces. This patient also has a grade 3 signal, incidentally, which is a signal which goes to the articular surface. Now, a grade 2 signal usually indicates degeneration. In a young patient, a horizontal tear can sometimes show like this. The important thing to know is that these tears are not seen by the arthroscopist because they are not extending to the articular surfaces. Whereas a grade three tear, or a grade 3 signal is always a tear. The only exception to this extension to the articular surface are the horizontal cleavage tears. These are the tears that extend through the substance of the meniscus. They go from the capsular margin all the way to the inner free margin. They are usually associated with parameniscal cysts. In all other tears, I insist on this volumetric imaging. What we do is we acquire a full 3D data set. We plan the axial images like this through the plane of the meniscus, in the plane of the meniscus, and we get images like this. Now, as you can imagine, once you have an image like this, it is quite easy then to describe the other characteristics of the tear. For example, this was a gentleman, this is the medial meniscus. He has a grade 3 signal. So I know that he has a tear. I don't know whether this is just a flap tear or is it a longitudinal tear. What is the exact length of that tear? But when I take an axial through the plane of the meniscus, I get an image like this. And now I can see this entire tear. I can give you an approximate length. I can give you its distance from the periphery. And I can tell you that it is not going into the root of the meniscus. So these are the things that a horizontal or an axial image through the meniscus can tell you. Similarly, now this is a radial tear, as seen on this graphic image. If I take a sagittal section through it, what I will see is, if this is a sagittal image, what I will see is a simple grade 3 signal extending to the top and to the bottom articular margins. I'm really not able to tell what is the thickness of this tear just on these sagittal images. Now what I do is I take these thin axial images through the tear, and I get a picture like this. And now I can tell you that this tear is actually extending into the red zone and is probably a repairable tear. Now, root tears are another variation of radial tears. These are axial images. That's the lateral meniscus seen in its entirety. And on the medial side, you see that there is a root tear. But I have to be able to identify these tears on sagittal and coronal images as well. So if I take a sagittal image through this torn zone, that is the normal anterior horn. And where I would normally see the posterior horn, I don't see anything. And that is perhaps why this is known as the ghost meniscus sign, which is that you simply just don't see a meniscus there. When you see this on the sagittal images, you have to think that this could be a root tear. So how does it look on all the different sequences on the sagittal image, normal anterior horn, where the root, posterior root should attach, I see a ghost meniscus. When I take a coronal through this, the lateral meniscus is fine. This medial meniscus, that is the torn edge. And I can now measure what is the distance from where it should attach on the tibia. I can assess the rest of this posterior horn. Can you see this degenerative signal inside the posterior horn? I can assess how much has this meniscus extruded outside the joint line. And I get a chance to assess the underlying articular cartilage, all of which are important when you have to decide about repairability. Bucket handle tears, you can see this exact picture on these thin axial images. That is the lateral meniscus. And look what's happening on the medial side. That's the anterior horn. And the entire body is flipped into the inside of the intercondylar notch. I see some signal in that torn meniscus. So perhaps this meniscus is also diseased. I know that the anterior root is attached, whereas I don't see the posterior root attachment. I should be able to identify a bucket handle tear on the sagittal images as well. And this brings us to the double PCL sign. Why double PCL? Because that is the normal PCL. And you see another structure anterior to it, which if you stretch your imagination a little bit, resembles a PCL. So it's the double PCL sign. This is nothing but the torn bucket handle of the bucket handle tear. Coming to the non-repairable menisci. So a flap tear, as you see, also shows a grade 3 signal, right? But it is slightly different from a longitudinal tear. One, it is short segment. Secondly, if you take the axial images, it has this kind of a parrot beak sort of an appearance. Okay, again, you have to stretch your imagination a little bit, but it's sort of a parrot beak appearance. That's how I know that this is a flap tear and not a vertical longitudinal tear. Complex tears, pretty simple, because they will have oblique, horizontal, and vertical components. Once again, non-repairable. Which brings us to ramp lesions, which are eminently repairable lesions, but which have to be suspected. They were hidden lesions, as Dr. IPS rightly said. How do I look for this? So I'm going to give you a pointer. That's the posterior horn of the medial meniscus. That is the meniscocapsular junction. Okay, there's no signal here. Whereas if you look here in the lower part of the posterior horn periphery, I do see a signal extending to the inferior articular margin. But how do I know that? What brought me to look at this here? Can you see this marrow edema? So whenever you have bone marrow edema, always look for the structures attached to that part of the bone. Either the cartilage or the meniscus is either torn or diseased. This is another patient who has a horizontal tear, but look at this. So he's very likely to have a meniscocapsular injury as well. Another important thing that MRI gives you is displacement of meniscal fragments. If you look at this body of the medial meniscus and look at this fragment that has torn and sort of extruded into the inferior meniscotibial recess. Once again, why did I think to look here? Just look at this inferior meniscotibial recess and look at the amount of fluid or synovitis there is there. So once I see this, I know there's something going on in this region. And that's what brings me to look at this. And if I take a sagittal image like this through this region, I can see that displaced torn meniscal tissue. Finally, and again, not the least, the articular cartilage. So this is a patient who has a complex kind of a tear at the junction of the body and posterior horn. But look at this articular cartilage. It's diseased. There are chondromalacic changes, subcortical cystic changes, which means this is grade 4 chondromalacia. If you look at the coronals, the lateral compartment looks great. Look at the medial compartment. Cartilage is fine till here, and all of this cartilage is diseased. So there are chondromalacic changes underlying this medial meniscal tear, and that will probably affect or modify the repairability or the repair surgery that gets done. I've just added these cartilage maps because, you know, they really help to look at the rest of the cartilage. So lateral compartment cartilage looks really good. The medial femoral condyle looks good. Most of the medial tibial is good, but look what's happening to the cartilage here. Few post-operative, few cases on post-operative meniscus, arthroscopy remains the gold standard. Okay, to decide whether a meniscal repair is intact or not, arthroscopy is the gold standard. But you really don't want to subject each and every patient to an invasive arthroscopic procedure. So we've tried to devise some criteria on MRI that help to indicate that perhaps this patient needs a re-look arthroscopy and a re-repair. The problem with this is that if you do an MRI too soon, you get a confusing picture. This is true of all post-operative scans. There are so many signals going around in a scan that is done too soon after surgery that then it is sometimes hard to assess what is real and what is not. Preferably a year and a half to 2 years down the line when everything has settled down is a better time to image that meniscus. But practically that is not possible. Very often patients present much earlier. So what would help is if the radiologist has access to the preoperative MRI so that I can take a look and see what the original tear looked like. And if I have surgical details as to what exactly was done, how much was repaired, how much was trimmed, then it becomes a little easier to interpret that post-op scan. Another problem with MRI is that the usual MRI criteria of abnormal signal and abnormal shape don't apply, because in the post-op meniscus, all of these are anyway abnormal, even in a healed meniscus. So we do use intravenous contrast. CCs of contrast into the anticubital vein. We take some images immediately after injection. Then we send the patient away. We tell them to walk around, go somewhere, come back after 2 hours. By that time, the contrast has had a chance to get into the joint space. Once the contrast is in the joint space, it behaves like an arthrogram. What are the MR criteria for healing? Now, one thing to be remembered, like I said earlier, is that grade 3 signals can remain within a repaired, healed repaired meniscus for many, many, many years after surgery. It is nothing but scar tissue. Unless that signal is bright like fluid, you do not call it a tear. Also, healed menisci will not enhance on contrast. And when you do an arthrogram, contrast will not extend into that repair. So let's see a few cases. If you see this proton density sagittal image in a meniscal repair, I see a grade 3 signal extending to the superior articular margin. These are the proton density images. Now, when we take a T2, which is the true T2 image of the knee, that signal sort of remains isointense, maybe turns slightly darker. This is a little fluid in the joint. So for this to be a tear, it has to look like this, okay? It will not enhance on contrast. And on the arthrogram images, there is absolutely no extension of contrast into that repair. Contrast that with this non-healed meniscal repair. Look what's going on. You have multiple really bright signals which are equal to this joint fluid. If you look on T2, they remain bright. On the contrast images, some part of those signals are enhancing, which means this is all granulation tissue. And 2 hours afterwards, you notice some fluid which shows contrast has come into the joint. All of this is just synovial enhancement, which is very commonly seen after surgery has been done. But this is fluid in the joint, which has now got some of that contrast. And you see it extending here into the tear, which means that this is either non-healed or re-torn. And finally, just one small case to show you a root repair. Ghost meniscus, which means that the root has gone. There is a tear on the axials. And on the post-operative scan, what you see is an ill-defined dark signal, little bit of gray isointense signal within it. I see the surgical tract and these are the axials of the same. So this is a nicely healed meniscal root repair. To conclude, if possible, you must image on 3 Tesla simply because you get very, very good high resolution images. Dedicated knee coil is important because then that coil sits close to the knee and you get really good images. Volumetric imaging with thin axial images through the plane of the meniscus are important because then you can tell the morphology of the tear, its extent, its distance from the periphery, root involvement, and so on. On MR, one can look for displaced torn meniscal tissue, which may have gone and gotten lodged in some recess. We can look for the status of the articular cartilage and the presence or absence of osteoarthritis. And all of this will probably then aid the surgeon in deciding whether this tear is repairable and what kind of repair should be done. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for an excellent presentation. So my question to you, because most of the people around the country, they are having in their center and even they are in big corporates, they are probably having 1.5. So what is your advice, how to go ahead and how can they have the best possible picture? Like it is not possible to have the three Tesla thing.
Everywhere.
What is your advice? They can go to the radiologist, they can ask for to know the best way possible in 1.5.
Okay. So a couple of things. One is that on a 1.5 Tesla, you can get fairly good images as well. What the radiologist has to do is increase the acquisition time. So now, supposing I can do an MRI of the knee in 10 minutes on a 3 Tesla, I increase that acquisition time to 15 or 17 minutes, and I can get much better images than if I keep the acquisition time low on a 1.5T. The second thing is this volumetric sequence is available on all scanners. It's a software. So if you download that or if you buy that software, you can get really good axial images as well. You just have to increase the acquisition time.
What is your actual indication of doing the contrast MR? Probably you don't do in acute setting, probably no. In the repair setting, post-op.
For evaluation of post-op.
Yeah.
Sometimes if it's an infected knee. Sometimes if you're looking at a possible...
I'm not going into that scenario. I'm just asking about the meniscus. Okay. I think Sachin is ready. Sachin, you can go ahead. Sachin, you are muted. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much, Swaranindu sir. And I'll be talking on meniscus repair techniques. So traditionally, if you look at the knee and what you see is the all inside technique towards the posterior third, the outside in for the anterior third. And the mid third was the area for the inside out. So that was essentially what was the traditional teaching. But I think with the advent of newer all inside devices and with the advent of new inside out cannulas, this has certainly changed a lot. The new zone specific cannulas now have expanded the indications of doing an inside out technique. And I think that has become my gold standard for doing most of my meniscus repairs now. But you now see that you have newer and better all inside devices, and they have also pushed the envelope for the zone to be repaired. So depending upon your patient's economic status and your familiarity with the technique, you can push the envelope essentially for inside out and the all inside techniques. What is essentially important is that, as Dr. IPS Oberoi suggested, you need to definitely improve your healing response by either doing rasping or doing synovial abrasion, creating vascular access channels, doing notch microfracture, or using a fibrin or a PRP clot. And all of these have shown to increase the healing rates tremendously. So we should look at it very quickly. Rasping is, I think, an important aspect. And you have this special instrument, which is a diamond tipped rasp in your surgical kit, in which you should gently abrade the surfaces of the menisci, as well as I've shown in the picture on the right side, you have to gently abrade the synovium as well, which leads to a healing response. The next way you're going to be using it is that you will use vascular access channels. There are two ways you can do it. You can either come in with your microfracture awl and make multiple vascular access channels, or what I prefer is to come in with a single lumen cannula and a simple inside out needle through the same and create multiple punctures. And the area that you need to create channels especially is the infra meniscal area, because that is where majority of the blood supply comes from. The third technique is to do a microfracture in the area of the intercondylar notch where you do not have insertion of the ACL. This is particularly important when you're doing an isolated meniscus repair without any ACL reconstruction, because if you're doing a ligament reconstruction concomitantly, you are creating tunnels which give you the same effect. And last but not the least, You can use a fibrin clot at times, in which you can create this by taking the patient's own venous blood, about 50 mils of it, and stirring it with a glass syringe piston for at least about 10 minutes. And then you leave it to sort of set at the back table, and then you can cut out these fibrin strips, which you can pack inside the tear and then suture your meniscus above the same. As Dr. Oberoi did suggest, the principle of doing a meniscus repair is to use vertical mattress sutures, both on the superior and the inferior surface, in an alternating manner, and you should be using non-absorbable sutures for the same. So let's start with the inside-out technique. And for this, you have what is called as the special suture that you use. You can either use 2-ohm Tychron, or you could use any of the high strength sutures. They are now attached to a loop, what is called as switch sutures. And then you pass these through special cannulas. There are two types of cannulas. You can have the double lumen cannula, which is what I've showed in this particular picture here, in which the two holes of the cannula are connected in the center with the help of a slot. So this allows for the suture to slide through the center while you can easily pass the needle on either side. So this is a very good way of starting off doing an in-out repair with the help of this special double lumen cannula, and this makes life a lot more easier. This will also allow you to pass sutures at a specific distance of 4.5 millimeters away from each other when you pull this suture through the same, which is again makes it very useful and a very good technique. However, I do not find much role of using these double lumen cannulas in my clinical practice now, because I find that they occupy too much space. And if they occupy too much space, then at times, you know, I don't want to be scratching cartilage. So to start off with, when you're starting off meniscus repair, you can use this first as a reduction tool. So you can hold to press the meniscus down to its base, and then you can pass needles, you know, through each of these lumen, pass them through the meniscus, through the capsule, retrieve them from an incision that you've made in the skin, either on the medial or the lateral side, which is the safety incision, and then retrieve both these needles out. And once you've retrieved them out, all that you have to do is to cut those needles away and then use the suture and try knots directly on to the capsule. So it will require you to master two skill sets. You need to learn how to make a medial and a lateral safety incision. And I would strongly encourage all our participants to definitely use these safety incisions, because they will ensure good safety. All that remains then is for you to use any form of a sliding, locking, or non-locking knot, and make sure that this knot is tied on the capsule and nowhere else. So these are the typical sets that we get with curved, straight, sort of bent cannulas, as well as you have the straight one. And my preference is to use a single lumen cannula, because I find it to be much more useful. So these were the cannulas that we would use, which would allow us to pass sutures in the in-out system. But now we have special zone-specific cannulas, which are designed for the right and for the left side, and they come as an anterior, mid, and post. And what these do is that they allow you to insert sutures in a larger area of the meniscus, which is my go-to system now, because this helps me cover a lot more sutures. A quick word on the safety incisions, both on the medial and on the lateral side. So on the lateral side, you make a vertical incision just posterior to the fibular collateral ligament. You then go in, you expose your biceps femoris, you take a transverse incision in the biceps femoris along the line of its posterior fibers, dissect it out so that you reach the space between the lateral gastroc and the capsule. And once you've achieved that, you can put a simple spoon, which is bent, so that then all your needles can come out very safely without you having to worry about the lateral popliteal nerve. This will also allow you to push your repair a lot more posterior. So here we are looking at a tear on the lateral side, which is extending posterior to the popliteus as well. You want to not stitch the popliteus in your repair. So you'll be placing sutures behind and in front of the popliteus. And what you want is that you want to use all inside sutures in the posterior third area. And I'm going to be using inside out sutures to repair rest of the meniscus. So here's a displaced tear of the lateral meniscus. It's an incomplete discoid tear as what we see here. It also has a horizontal cleavage component. So as you would tackle all displaced discoid lateral meniscus tears, you first want to debride the tear. You want to ensure that the tear is reducible. And I use my single lumen cannula, which is a straight cannula here, to see if the tear is reducible and goes back to its original position. I then go ahead and I proceed with the simple saucerization and debridement of the tear. I look at the horizontal cleavage component. Oh. I want to tackle that horizontal cleavage component as well. And then I come in with the zone-specific cannulas. The first suture is either the anterior suture or the mid-third suture, and it acts like a temporary reduction stitch. So just like when you're doing a complex fracture, you want to get the key components of the fracture together first and hold it with a temporary reduction K-wire. So similarly, I tend to put in my first suture either anterior or in the mid area so that now I can have my whole meniscus sort of sitting back exactly where it should be. And then I can start passing my sutures in front and behind the same. What is important to understand is that you don't want to be tightening your sutures at the same time. You want to slowly and steadily start progressively tightening them as you come to the end. Then we go to the posterior third area where I'm using an all inside device. And for using these all inside devices, especially in the posterior third of the lateral meniscus, you need to be very careful of the posterolateral bundle, which is almost about 4 to 6 millimeters right behind it. So here we are now coming with a curved zone-specific cannula, especially for the lateral posterior third. And you can see here that I use my needle, which I've protruded outside as a joystick to reduce the meniscus. And even with the help of a good posterior safety incision, I can repair tears as posterior as possible with the same without fearing for any risk to the neurovascular bundle. So that's in a nutshell how you would do a tear on the, you would do a lateral sided repair. On the medial side, things are a lot more simpler. Here we want to put sutures in large medial meniscus tear. And of course you want to do the posterior third zone with the help of all inside devices. You want to do the majority of chunk with the help of in-out devices. And for the extreme anterior third, you're going to be using an outside-in. So how do you do an outside-in repair? So if you're doing an outside-in repair, either for a radial tear or for anterior third tear, you want to come in with 2 16-gauge needles. You want to pass the suture through the posterior needle. You want to pass your snare through the anterior needle. Retrieve the suture through the snare, take it out of your portal. Then you want to withdraw the needle that takes the suture, because if you withdraw the needle that takes the snare, it may accidentally lacerate your suture. And then you want to withdraw the other needle as well, and then pull the sutures down and tie them. So that is how you'll do an outside in. To do an outside in, you need to be very specific as to where you want to place your needles. And the best way to do it is to keep your hook probe exactly at the area where you want to repair it. And then with your finger, you palpate the same from the exterior. The other way to do it is to actually take your scope exactly to the area where you want to repair it. And then you shut the OT light so that you see transillumination, and that becomes a good sort of good landmark as to where you can go ahead and do your repair. So here we are again on the medial side, coming with a straight cannula and putting vertical matrix sutures. As I said, you want to alternate sutures on the superior and the inferior surface. So here we are putting sutures on the superior surface first. And after we do a superior surface stitches, the whole meniscus will evert. And once it everts, then you can very easily and very conveniently pass your sutures either inside out or all inside on the undersurface, which makes it really, really, really attractive to repair. So I'm going to encourage all of you to really learn the art of using inside out sutures. You'll be using, you can easily train yourself with all these lovely cadaveric programs that the Indian Arthroscopy Society conducts. We'll wait for all these difficult COVID times to get over. And I think once they get over, all our IAS training labs will be completely open, and doing meniscus repairs is a technique that we teach with a lot of passion in our IAS cadaveric courses. So that's how a completed repair should look. You should be placing sutures at least about 3 to 4 millimeters distance, which is completely important. And then for the anterior most area, you can use an outside in technique. So here we are with 2 16-gauge needles. The suture is on the posterior needle. The snare is on the anterior needle, as what we've shown here. You want to again put vertical mattress sutures. You withdraw the suture from the posterior repair with the help of a fine mosquito type of a hemostat. You withdraw it out through the portal. And now what you want to do is to withdraw the needle that contains the suture first in this particular fashion there. And now, since you have everything sort of captured within the snare, you withdraw the second needle as well. And that's how you will place a suture for the anterior third. How do I rehab my meniscus tears? Well, depending upon the size of the tear, I allow them to do 0 to 90 degrees of flexion for the first 2 to 3 weeks, and then get them to do a full flexion. For larger tears, I will keep them partially bearing for 3 weeks. For smaller tears, I will get them to allow full weight bearing right on day one. And for larger tears, again, I will place them in a long knee brace for about 3 weeks. And then if the need be, place them on a protective brace afterwards. They're allowed cycling and gymming only after 6 to 8 weeks, depending upon the stability of the tear. So to conclude, lateral meniscus requires you to repair it more than the medial side. And Dr. IPS has very effectively brought that out, because the lateral side is a convex on convex. And that's why you need to repair it more than the medial side. You need to be very well versed with the inside out and the all inside techniques. And with these two techniques, you'll be able to repair at least 98% of all tears. So thank you very much. I will stop here so that we can move on to the next talk, which is essentially going to be, how do I apply these techniques in my OT, which will be taken by Dr. Gopinath. So over to you, Swarnendu sir, for further instructions, comments, and any questions, if at all any.
Excellent, as always. This is a rule that when Sachin will be speaking, everything will be as simple as possible, but don't look at Sachin, he is too expert. You have to follow the principle, what he is telling, okay? So in between, when my dear Gopi is ready with Gopi, can you share your screen in between when Gopi is coming with his presentation? There is a question in the chat box, Sachin.
Yes.
At what flexion angle do you fix your medial, suppose in posterior third, for the medial side and for the lateral side? That is the one question from one of our viewers.
So that is a very good question. So here you have to follow and respect the principles of your meniscus. So when I'm repairing mid zone tears, I will tighten them in near extension. When I go to the posterior third area, if I'm using an all inside technique, then I'll be sort of repairing them with the knee flex to about 30 degrees. So that's what I would normally use. I would use roughly about 30 degrees for the posterior third, and I will repair or I will tighten the sutures in near extension for the mid and the anterior third zone.
Okay, Sachin. So another one thick question is there. At how many times, suppose out of 10 of your medial meniscus repair in probably in the middle posterior third, and how many times you do your picrusting for the MCL?
So as a rule, if I'm doing arthroscopy for meniscus repairs for the medial side, I will do picrusting in 98% of all my therapeutic meniscus procedures, unless there is someone in whom there is an MCL tear and, you know, nature has done the pie crusting for me.
That is a different story.
Yes.
So I think Gopi, you are ready with, Gopi is ready. Sachin, I am going with Gopi then.
Thank you. Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Gopi, you have to unmute. Gopi, you have to unmute. Space bar. Just put the space bar on. Once you strike the space bar, please. Yes, done.
Hello?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. I take this opportunity to thank IAS for giving me the opportunity to present this topic in front of this public audience. My job is made simple by Dr. Sachin Tapasi and IAS, who has mentioned most of the things. So I'll just quickly rush through what are the instruments needed and how do you use it in the operating case. Your meniscal toolbox should contain pushes, the implant, for inside out and outside in technique. The most important is to have a shoulder set. If you are a good shoulder surgeon, then meniscal repair thing is very easy. You should have a shoulder set with lateral suture passes, lateral, and meniscal suture passes like a scorpion, the spinal needle, and you should need a smaller fiber wires, 0 and 20, and suture tape, and the PDS. So these are the simple things which should be available with you. And most of the time, we'll decide about the repair once you put the scope in. So we have to arrange everything in the OT, and which will help you in a difficult situation, we don't know. So it's better that you arrange most of the instruments which are available to you in the OT. Now, this is an instrument tray. It looks so busy. So you have to identify and you have to have a thinking method on what you are going to do with the meniscus. Now, equipment needed are different for different injuries and different zones of the meniscus. And all inside repair has been a gold standard for the posterior, which is already highlighted by Dr. Sachin Tapasi. And the equipment needed, we know, are different, and different companies are coming daily with the different instruments to repair, to do an all inside technique. But we should all remember that when a meniscus is injured, you can do a meniscus based repair or a capsular based repair. So when you do a meniscus to meniscus repair, most of these techniques described cannot be used. So here you are attaching your meniscus and tightening all the sutures outside the capsule. That means you are doing a meniscus to capsule repair. So all inside is mainly a capsular based instrument system where you access the middle third and posterior. And many of the times you don't need, or most of the, you will not need an additional incision like an inside out technique. Doesn't need a trained assistant. And but there are some disadvantages. It's a structural damage to the meniscal tissue, and if you are not an expert, you can do a misfiring, and it is a costly implant. And you should know that once it is wasted inside the knee joint, then who will pay for this implant? These are the basic issues we should know, and how to get over it. So if you have incorrect deployment, you are unnecessarily putting a plastic implant in the joint. And then what will happen to that, we don't know. So it interferes with the meniscus natural mobility because you are attaching a meniscus to the capsule and you are not doing a meniscus to meniscus repair. Because if you have a bucket handle there, a good meniscus on the periphery, and you are attaching the inner fragment to the outer fragment and everything to the capsule. That means you are reducing the mobility of the meniscus. So these are the instruments used for an all-inside technique. Now we look for some instruments which can be used for a meniscus-based repair. The fixation is contained completely in the meniscus. You are repairing a meniscus to meniscus. You have anatomical reduction. You have a 360-degree compression of the meniscal tissue, not the capsule to the meniscus, and preserve the native meniscus translation and mobility. And it's very important that it will not cause any neurovascular injury and reduce postoperative pain. Suppose you do a lateral meniscus repair with an inside-out technique or all-inside technique, and if you add the popliteus tendon in, it's going to be very painful. So you have some instruments which should be available in your operation theater, for it should be a low profile, versatile, efficient, and anatomy. And one example is a knee sphere, where you can use as you do in a shoulder surgery. So what you do is you can take a shoulder scorpion or shoulder suture passer. You can do a bite just outside the hair, the peripheral part. So withdraw your instrument again. You take one more bite. So here you are going to get a compression between the meniscal tissue. So this is a very useful instrument, and it should be available in your instrument tray. Only thing is you need a 0 or a 2-0 fiber wire and this instrument. So you can do a meniscus to meniscus repair. So when we look at most of the development in the meniscus repair, we should, I think, focus on instruments which can be used for a meniscus to meniscus repair. And of course, the instruments which are used on a capsular-based technique are gold standard, but this technique should be there in your operation theater when you attempt the most advanced meniscal repair technique. So it's an instrument which can be used for a meniscal root repair. It can be used for radial tear, horizontal tear, even bucket handle tear. And this instrument can also be even used for an ACL repair, especially if you have an ACL avulsion in the femoral side. So this is a very versatile instrument. I think in future, there will be more development on this, and so that there will be a further low profile instrument which can be used for every part of the meniscus, and you can do all inside meniscus to meniscus repair. So you need a scorpio or wiper or lasso. Lasso is a useful instrument again, where we use in a shoulder joint, and this is especially important when you repair the meniscus, especially in the where the capsular avulsions of the meniscus, like a ramp lesion, which I'll come to in the next slide. So these are the instruments which should be ready in your operation theater if you really want to do a good repair of the meniscus. And the important advantage of this instrument is that these are not disposable instruments. You can reuse it, especially the knee scorpion is a metal instrument, so it is not disposable. So you can use it several times. So the meniscus-based repair can be used for a longitudinal tear, horizontal tear, for a circumferential compression between the two meniscal fragments. The radial tear, side-to-side reduction is possible. You can take bites from both sides of the radial tear and you can do a good repair so that you get a good compression between the two meniscal fragments. And they can be used for complex tears and ramp lesions. A lasso is a very good instrument. And for the root tears, you have jig. I'll come to that in the next slide. So intact meniscal rib tissue is a must for this. And there should be some tissue where you can take some bite on the peripheral part of the tissue. So this instrument should be available in your operation. So this is useful for a longitudinal tear. And this is how you do an all-inside repair with a meniscal scorpion. Just take a bite on the peripheral fragment. Then you withdraw the instrument. Then you pass it again and you take another bite. It's a very simple technique. And when you have a low-profile instrument, it's easy to do. So once you do that, you can do just like you do a shoulder surgery. You can do a knot tying and you can cut it. You can introduce it once more and then you can get 2 or 3 or 4, whatever number of the sutures you need on a longitudinal tear. And this can be repeated even in a radial tear. You can take bites on either side and compress it. You can take 1, 2, or 3 sutures on either side of the radial tear and you get a good compression between the meniscal tissue. Radial tear, you can take bites on either side. You can introduce the instrument, get bites on the outermost part first, then middle, and come to the inner part. So you get a good connection between the meniscal tissue. So this is a very useful instrument. This is an example of how you can use this instrument. And this is a radial tear. You are taking a suture on one side first, on the peripheral part. Then you withdraw the instrument, introduce it again, and you get another bite on the outermost part on the periphery. And then once you have that, you have two switches on either side. And when you tie that, you have a good repair of a radial tear. So this is a very useful instrument for repairing the all inside technique with a meniscus to meniscal tissue compression. And you can do any number of repairs you want. You can combine it with an outside in technique or an inside out technique. But for a radial tear, also this is a very amenable. And this horizontal tear, the same instrument can be used for that. You have a horizontal tear here. So you can take a bite on the side. And then you withdraw. This is an all inside instrument. So you need not pass anything outside the joint or the capsule. So there is now a compression of the capsule and the meniscus. So the mobility of the meniscus is very much preserved when you use such advanced instruments. And technically, it is very easy, and the learning curve is so easy, especially if you are a shoulder surgeon also. So root repair, you need a special jig in your instrument tray. And if you have a root tear, we know that it's going to cause a lot of osteoarthritis, and you are going to have a lot of cartilage damage. So this is, again, the same instrument can be used to take the bite from the root. So you have a jig to make a hole, foramen hole you make from the tibia, like do an ACL. You have an ACL jig, or you can use special jig for the posterior root. So once you withdraw this, once you take a bite, the same for the one, and take out the sutures, you have a good compression. And actually, the root of the meniscus will pass through the hole which you have made, and you can tie the sutures down. So this is an instrument which should be ready in your tray for a posterior root repair, and a knee fascia also is very useful for doing a root repair. So these are the instruments which should be ready if you are planning for a root repair, and the bite and the meniscus is actually taken by the same sutured fascia. So it can be used for a meniscal extrusion or a meniscotibial ligament avulsion along with root repair, and ramp lesion. A lasso is a very useful instrument. The same lasso you use for shoulder surgery, you can pass the lasso through the meniscal tissue and you can get a good compression. So this is a lasso being used. So you pass the sutures from outside in, and then it's all under arthroscopic vision, outside in, I mean, in the joint only. So you pass the sutures from peripheral part of the meniscus, and then you can tie it. So lasso is a useful instrument. So every time you go for a knee meniscal repair, you should keep ready the instrument for the shoulder as well. So this is already highlighted by Dr. Sachin Tabuke. I'll not go for that. Lateral meniscus posterior root. Instead of putting an inside-out technique for a youngster, which is likely to create neurovascular problems, you can try a suture passer and try to repair the posterior root from all inside, rather than going for inside-out on the posterior horn of the lateral meniscus. If you do that, you have to put an incision. You have to expose everything. You cannot do it blindly, especially on the lateral side, lateral meniscus, posterior one. So biomechanical is already highlighted. The sutures, medical sutures are the best. And for every zone, you should have special instrument. And you should not approach the meniscus with the same instrument everywhere. For every zone, you are going to have a different set of instruments which should be ready in your tray. Before you embark on a meniscus. So you cannot look for an instrument in between surgery. So it is better that you have everything in your hand before you go to the actual surgical operation theater. So these are already shown by Dr. Sachin Tabassi, the outside in technique, outside in technique. Then these are the simple suture passes or simple needles available, and nitinol wires. These are all there in shoulder set. You can use for meniscus also. And this is already highlighted. I'll just skip through this slide. It's an outside in technique. You need only some cannulas or 15 gauge needles, but you have special needles also, micro suture lasso, which is available, and you can make it ready. Or just 15 gauge needle is enough for an outside in repair. But for an inside out technique, as it's already highlighted, you really need these own specific cannulas. Here, just you need 15 gauge needle, and this is already highlighted by Dr. Sachin Tabassi, so I'll not go to the details of that. On what instrument should be there, Dr. Sachin Tabassi has already shown. Now, this is also well described by Dr. Sachin Tapasi. He has shown about phone-specific cannulas for every phone. You need an inside-out technique, and we have needles available for every phone. And previously, we used to have different needles for different phones. Now, we have phone-specific cannulas. When it was introduced first, we used to have different needles for different phones. So this phone-specific cannula is really useful for inside-out technique, and this should be ready in your hand. But when you go for the posterior one-third or the medial or lateral meniscus, especially the lateral meniscus, it's better that you have the incisions exposed, everything, and then see how the just comes out. So there are some disadvantages and advantages for inside-out technique, which I will not go into because already highlighted. And you need instruments for rasping, vascular access channel, trephinization to increase the vascularity in your instrument set. So you need a diamond rasp always needed. Otherwise, your meniscus is not going to heal. You need a notch microfracture, which is available in knee set. You can take some microfractures. You can do that to increase the vascularity and some sort of a stem cell formation. So you need a fibrin float. But PRP stem cells are not available to us. So these are the instruments and techniques you should be available with you when you embark on a meniscus repair. So that is about the things available and should be available in the OT. So when you talk about the anterior horn, you can use an outside-in technique. So inside-out for the middle third and all inside for the posterior. This is a standard teaching. But if you have advanced instrumentation, most of the things can be done from all inside, especially with the knee suture passer like a Proprio. So anatomical reduction with your instruments are the most important. No gapping should be there. There should be compression of the tear site so that it will heal. You need a biological preparation with a good graft with augmentation and neurostimulation as needed. Circumferential compression. Compress the superior, middle, and inferior aspects of the meniscus. If possible, always try to get a meniscus to meniscus repair with compression at the tear site, rather than looking at a meniscus to the capsule compression. But the gold standard is meniscus to capsule repair. I think in future, we'll all learn meniscus to meniscus repair, and the devices needed for everything are different. Once again, thanks IAS for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, dear Gopi, for your excellent presentation. And you have all been told that what should be the armamentarium when you go inside your this thing. Because sometimes you go with your ACL repair and you were completely been frightened that to see a big meniscal tissue lying in front, and probably you can repair that, but you don't have the instrument. So this is the purpose of the meeting was that to make the viewers aware that sometimes you can have this sort of things with you so that you can repair that. So one question to Sridhar. Sridhar, are you, please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir.
There is a question for you. What suture material you use for your meniscal repair?
Sir, mostly I prefer doing only all inside. This thing, if at all I use ethylon, sir, for a cost purpose or fiber wire.
Okay, so you mostly suppose we do for the middle third, what is your suture choice?
Fiber wire, sir. Nowadays, I am preferring fiber wire, number two fiber wire.
Tanmay, what is your choice of suture?
Either 2-hung 2-0 fiber wire. That's the best.
That is the best. A preloaded one, this should needle with the needle.
Either or. For inside out, obviously, you can't without the needles.
Yeah, obviously, you have to have the needle and the fiber wire, okay.
I mean, either of which. If you're using a scorpion, then you can do it without that. And if you're with the needle, you're using those inside out cannulas, then of course, with the needles.
IPS have told us that there is no like 3-4 months, 5 months, you can go with the meniscal repair if it is repairable. What is your opinion, Sridhar, on that? Do you have any time limit on that?
It's an intra-op decision, sir. Usually intraoperative, if I find that the rim of the meniscus tear is fine, looks healthy, and it can be repairable, I go ahead with the repair. And before that, I'll counsel the patient saying that if at all any chance, I can repair this, and there is a chance of re-tear rate or failure. So beforehand, I'll counsel the patient, I'll tell them. So it can be possible, I can repair it or I can go with a meniscectomy.
Tanmay, do you have any time limit for any meniscal repair?
No timeliness, as the other, as Dr. Oberaid mentioned very clearly, we have to be very specific with all your factors taking in for a comprehensive answer to that. Because it's not just one thing, that just the time which we decide, which decides everything. If it's lateral meniscus, obviously you are more, have better prognostic factors. Then if the patient is young, then there are other factors we have to see, limb alignment and other co-associated comorbidities and other associated injuries. So according to that, we have to take a call. It's time limit is, even I have repaired after an, 8 months and 1 year also we have repaired and they have doing well.
Gopi, you have got something to add on? Yes, Gopi. You have to unmute yourself. Yes.
Regarding first fiber, what we do is we do lot of shoulder surgery. So we save the fiber wire which is there for rotator cuff for lateral repair. We do ETO and use the same fiber wire meniscal repair. So post fracture wise, we always use fiber wire. We save the fiber wire from the shoulder surgery and then use it for knee.
But the shoulder fiber wire, sir, could too thick for the meniscus. What is your opinion, IPS?
Yeah, I think we for the meniscus repair, we usually need a 2-0 fiber wire, which is a thinner diameter fiber wire. Shoulder usually has a bigger fiber wire. It's size 1 or size...
Because that sort of bigger fiber wires can be used only in the meniscal root. Otherwise, if you use that in the meniscal body, then it will probably tear apart the meniscus.
Yes.
Why is Sachin? I cannot find Sachin.
So I think Sachin...
Dr. Sachin has to leave. So yes, I think I have got a couple of questions for Dr. Anupama.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So there is a question from Dr. Sajir from Mumbai. He wants to know any tips on MRI to differentiate an acute and chronic root tear.
Yeah. So I get, forget about root tear. Any tear, I get this question all the time. Is it acute or is it chronic? It is impossible to tell whether it is acute or chronic. As far as the root tear goes, in a chronic tear, what could happen is that you could get osteoarthritic changes in the underlying bone and in the chondromalacic changes in the cartilage. Once you start getting those kind of changes, you can assume that this is a chronic tear, like the last case that I showed. As long as there is bone marrow edema under the tear, perhaps it is still an acute tear.
And there is one question from Dr. Nagaraj Shetty from Mumbai only. Any role of weight-bearing knee MRI? One, that is dynamic meniscus extrusion assessment, pre-op and post-op root tears. And second, meniscus repair, post-op evaluation. So does MRI has any role?
Post-op, she has already been evaluated. Post-op, yeah. I think she has already...
Dynamic as in weight-bearing?
Yes, correct.
Yeah, but that's not possible to do.
That is not possible anyway. Anyway, that is directly how can you do the MRI in a standing position? It's possible. It's not possible even in a lying down position. If you flex and extend this knee model is not going to work.
I have a question.
Some people are researching on the shoulder dynamic one. Ma'am, I am correct on that. Some people
are researching. For example, in the spine,
on the shoulder one.
Like in the spine also.
Yes.
They take images in flexion and in extension to look for load bearing on the spine, but it's not there in clinical practice yet, not for the knee.
Sridhar,
yes,
IPS, please.
I have a question. These ramp tears are usually posterior tears, and when you do an MRI extension, the ramp tear actually reduces itself. So more often you are going to miss the ramp tears. So is there a way to detect the ramp tear?
So our way of detecting a ramp tear is not by how much it is seen on arthroscopy. See, my way is to look for signal. So if you have bright signal at the meniscocapsular interface, there should not be any bright signal there because the capsule is dark. If you get bright signal there, which is extending to the articular margin, and as an added bonus, if there is some underlying marrow edema, you can be fairly confident that there is a meniscocapsular separation. Or if you get signal between the meniscus and the underlying tibia, normally the meniscus sits flush with the bone. There should be no signal between the meniscus and the underlying bone.
Okay.
The moment you start seeing fluid there, you can be sure that there is some separation that is starting.
That's a good
point. Sridhar.
Yes, sir.
Do you have any age limit criteria? Because I am asking these questions because I am sitting with the Learned faculty. Because their problem is that there are some American Association guideline on this 6-7 guidelines for this meniscal repair. Do you follow that guideline or not? Yes or no?
No, sir. No.
You don't follow.
No.
You do follow the American guideline, or you follow if it is repairable, I will repair. Anmay.
So if it's repairable, if it's on arthroscopy, if you see it's a repairable thing, obviously we'll give it a chance. But for all my patients, I already in the OPD, I tell them that they have this prognosis of they have this 50% or 70% chance of a repair or a retear. But depending on the age, if the patient is young, I do give him a chance of a repair.
The question to Rajiv,
counsel them accordingly.
Rajiv, just one question to you. Suppose there is a 3 millimeter peripheral red joint tear, 30 years, 3 months. Three centimeter
tear. 3 centimeter, you have to repair.
Everybody agrees on that.
Definitely will repair.
So this is the message from all the London faculty. 3 centimeter, whatever might be the age and time duration, you have to go with the repair if it is a red zone. So IPS, you agree on that?
Yeah, this is what I said in my presentation. I mean,
yes. Ranjit, do you have any question to anybody? Ranjit, you have to unmute yourself. Ranjit, you have to space
unmute,
bar.
Unmute first.
Yes.
Yeah, the questions to Dr. IPS.
Yeah, Ranjit.
What is your plan for the treatment of the degenerative meniscal tear? Degenerative meniscal tear. So, how do you deal with degenerative meniscal tear?
So, Ranjit, we usually try and avoid arthroscopy in a degenerative knee condition. My indication of doing an arthroscopy in a degenerative joint are 4. Number one, that the patient should have an acute on a chronic problem. So he was a painful knee who was carrying out for maybe a couple of months now, and suddenly the pain has increased. So there has to be a reason for the pain to increase. And if I don't find any significant reason on an MRI and clinical examination, and I can localize that the patient is having some kind of acute chondral injury or a meniscal injury, I would do an arthroscopy. Number two, these patients should have mechanical symptoms if I am planning to do an arthroscopy. Number three, their varus or a valgus deformity should not be more than 5 to 7 degrees. If they are having severe deformities, my arthroscopy will fail. And number four, on an MRI or an X-ray, I find a very significant osteochondral or a chondral damage which has happened. Treating meniscus in a degenerative knee is not going to help. Degenerative knee, yeah. The acute pain is due to synovitis, acute pain is due to an osteochondral or a chondral injury, or due to an inflammation which has happened. These degenerative meniscal tear are incidental findings. Unless and until you find a big piece which is actually coming in between and is pretty unstable, you just gently debride it. Don't excise it too much. You don't want to unroof the meniscus completely because it is still having some kind of cushion function which is there, and you should not excise it completely. So arthroscopy in a degenerative condition, you have to be very, very cautious and have to really counsel the patient well.
Okay,
we have one question.
Dr. Gopi.
Yes, Ranjit, Bilaris has got one question. Ranjit.
Dr. Jai Prasad, he wants to ask some question to Dr. IPS.
Yes.
Go ahead, Jai Prasad, sir.
Yeah, this question is for IPS and Samantha. In patients who has ACL tear and the meniscus, where you are going to do a meniscectomy, okay, ACL tear with meniscectomy, do you want to compensate the meniscectomy with the ALL?
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, the meniscus, posterior horn of the late lateral and medial meniscus, biomechanically, it is a secondary stabilizer for the rotational and anterior posterior stability. Do you recommend or do you practice ALL for the secondary stability of the lost meniscus with the ACL?
Question to Joya, brother. My question to Joya, whether he believes in ALL or he has ever seen the ALL in anatomical lab.
He's offline now.
Okay.
No worries. I think if Jay is hearing is, the mechanism with which the meniscus posterior horn works is something like a door stopper mechanism.
Door stopper, yeah.
the mechanism with ALL is working is totally different. So you cannot compensate the loss of medial meniscus with an augmentation of ALL in such cases.
Yes.
That is why it is important to repair meniscus, especially posterior horn, wherever it is possible. In patients who have lost meniscus completely, essentially in the posterior horn, then indication of meniscus transplant comes in. Then the door stopper mechanism will be taken care if we're transplanting a meniscus. Compensating it by putting an ALL doesn't work that way.
My question to ma'am, can you comment something on ALL or MRI?
I knew that was coming. You can see the ALL in at least 75% of patients.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What you have to do, I'll tell you what you have to do. Look at the coronal scan. Identify the iliotibial band. Okay. Keep following that iliotibial band to its posterior part. You will see a very thin linear structure going from somewhere between the popliteal and lateral collateral ligament attachment on the femur and coming down to the anterolateral tibia. Okay. And you will actually be able to see a little part of it going and attaching to the meniscus as well. So in almost 75% of especially young patients, you can identify the ALL. Now, whether you believe it in it or not.
Madam, the next question is, you probably appreciate, what is your, in 3 Tesla machine, the thickness of this ALL?
What is the thickness?
How you identify?
Maybe it's a capsular thickness.
It's a capsular thickening.
It's a capsular thickening, yeah.
So I think IPS, we don't agree on that. We are going to repair, reconstruct the ALL.
Yeah, that is true. Let me ask a question to all the panelists here. How do you manage a parameniscal cyst? I think parameniscal cyst is something, how do you manage it? So maybe Sridhar, you have a meniscus
cyst,
a
parameniscal cyst.
So just after decompression and you do a meniscus surgery?
Yes, sir. If it's a smaller one, I do decompression and take care of the meniscus. If it's a very huge one, so which you can see from the outside, then I do from outside also.
Yeah, yeah. That was my question actually. Yeah. Because sometimes you might need open to do it from outside. You have outside to excise it.
Yeah.
Rajiv, sometimes these parameniscal cysts are actually multilocular as well.
Yeah.
Just decompressing it might not be. There might be multiple parameniscal cysts, more than one.
Recur.
And they can recur. And the patients, on an MRI, if they find another cyst, they actually blame you that they have not decompressed it completely.
Yeah. So this message should be clear to all the viewers that he should not have this ego that I can decompress all the meniscal cysts by arthroscopy only.
Yeah.
Tell the patient that they take the consent that I might have a small incision on the outside so that I can debride it totally. So this is, there is no surgical ego. Thing is that there is no ego and there should be a consent on that. Agreed, IPS?
Yeah, I agreed. Absolutely.
Gopi is willing to add. Gopi?
I have a question to IPS. If you have a root tear with a varus deformity, you do root repair and correction of varus deformity of knee in a single stage or different stages, or is it a must that you should correct the varus in a root tear? Or is there any association between root tear?
Yeah, so in a patient with root tear with a varus deformity, you have to be very, very sure that the patient does not have significant arthritis. Because if patient already has a significant arthritis, doing root repair will be useless. It will not work. If arthritis is less and you think this varus is more than the physiological varus, which you compare with the other side, then you would actually go ahead and do a root repair with osteotomy at the same setting. Because if you leave the varus there and just do a root repair, it's going to fail. So you have to do an osteotomy at the same sitting. How I do in these cases, I don't do a tunnel then. Because then I have an issue because there's a tunnel and then there is an osteotomy. So I would rather use an anchor from behind. So I usually make a posterior medial portal, put a cannula in the back, use an anchor, the shoulder anchor in the back, and then do stitching of the root. So it's an anchor-based stitching and an osteotomy. Yeah.
Medial open wedge.
Yeah, it's usually medial open wedge for almost all the osteotomies which I do.
If there is a patellofemoral arthritis in the same patient, you do medial open wedge or lateral close wedge? Patellofemoral joint.
Yeah. So normal. No. What I do a medial open wedge osteotomy is a biplanar osteotomy. So you have a plane of osteotomy which is going like this, which is going from the medial side to the superior part of the tibiofibular joint. And there is another plane which is an L shape which is going behind the tibial tubercle. Depending upon the patellofemoral arthritis and position of patella, The second osteotomy, I can plan either going up or going down. So that I want to take the patellar tendon and the osteotomy with the lower fragment, or I want to leave it with the upper fragment. Is it clear?
Yes,
so it's a biplanar osteotomy. You can change the direction from layer to the other way around. And then you can decompress the patellofemoral joint.
This is clear, but this is a big topic. Gopi, I'm not falling into your trap, because if I go and fall into a trap, probably it will take another half an hour, 1 hour to on that discussion with that, how you decompress the patellofemoral joint. Okay, that is a biplanar one with the tomofix or whatever.
So there are some questions coming in. I think if you can read the questions. Sandeep, there are some questions there.
Yes.
There is one question with IPS, sir.
Yeah.
So IPS, sir. So how do you manage tunnel when ACL with root repair?
ACL with root repair?
How do you manage tunnels?
The direction is totally different.
Totally different tunnels.
Totally different direction. So don't worry. My problem is when I do an osteotomy with a root repair, there are some issues. But with a root repair and an ACL, the tunnel direction is totally different. So don't worry about that. You can just change the angle and just change the direction.
So with the osteotomy as well. Sorry, yeah, I'm interrupting.
With osteotomy, you can play. Yeah, you can if you have a patient which is having very soft bone, especially
female, osteoporotics, yeah.
Osteoporotic female patients with varus and short stature,
then
the bone is triangular and the space is less. So you can't play with osteotomy and tunnel for the root repair. And that is why I use an anchor.
Very true.
So there is a question here. What do you do for irreducible lateral meniscus bucket handle tear? Any releases or pie crusting? That's a question from Dr. Raju Ishwaran. So I think let's start with Gopi. Gopi, irreducible lateral meniscus tear. Any releases would you do or pie crusting?
Lateral meniscus irreducible usually it is not very common. Medial meniscus we see that. Lateral meniscus pie crusting we don't do. And it all depends on the duration of the irreducible meniscus. So if it is an acute one, usually it will be reducible. If it is a chronic one, you can do a pie crusting of the ITB and then try to reduce.
Shridhar, have you done a pie crusting of ITB anything?
No, no.
That is why I said. I was quite...
Maybe with the FECA4, we should be able to do that.
I have also never done the pie crusting of the
knee
ITB.
Knee replacement patients operated for valgus knees, they do pie crusting from inside out, the Ranavar technique. But arthroscopic pie crusting, never heard about it, Gopinath. So is it a special technique to do it, or can you just let us know?
No, that is a different technique. That is a different technique. Probably IPS, you are right that you follow. When you do the valgus, you do the Kiblis and the Ranabad. Both you combine.
But that's for knee replacement.
That is a knee discussion. We are not going into the fall again on the trap of Raju. So
let us answer Raju's question. Raju, lateral meniscus sometimes is difficult. But I think figure of four position, instead of just doing a valgus, sometimes figure of four actually opens up pretty well. You need to really push hard on the medial part of the tibial condyle in a figure of four position. Invariably, you are able to do it. Sometimes there is some kind of fibrosis which causes the meniscus not to reduce. You don't do any releases, but you debulk a part of meniscus because it becomes rolled up. And when it becomes rolled up, you can't reduce it. You just debulk it gently and see if you are able to reduce it. The problem happens if you are unable to reduce it. Don't try to repair it. It's going to come back again in the intercondylar notch and it is going to fail. So yes, you'd take it in figure of four position, put a strain so that it opens. I'm not very well aware of pie crusting technique. I'm happy to hear it later, Dr. Gopinath. And then do gently debulking of the meniscus, especially posteriorly and anteriorly, so that you're able to reduce the meniscus. And if it is not reducing still, not a good idea to repair these meniscus.
Sridhar, I've got a question to you. Yes, Tanmay, please.
Yeah, just adding one point to Dr. IBS, sirs. That what we can do is we can use a single cannula of the inside out if we have, and then just push it through and take a traction suture through that and keep. Ask your assistant to pull it, or you can tie it up with a mosquito to your drape. So that will keep pulling and reduce. That will keep that meniscus in the reduced position, and then you can start off with your all inside for the posterior third, and then start taking the other superior and inferior inside out sutures.
Yeah, I think Tanmay, you're right. Taking but a decision of it should not be too hard. If he is pulling too
of course,
hard,
of course, of course.
Practically speaking, when you make the figure of position, usually when you push with the probe, usually falls back into the position. Usually, I have never found that irreducible. This thing is something I have never probably. Raju might
at times it comes back. So for that, we can use this traction suture thing.
Yeah, yeah, that is a good technique, but not with the pie crusting one. Sridhar, I have got a question to you, Sridhar.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I have got a question to you. Do you use your this mini scorpion in using this mini scorpion, either the mini one or the disposable one? What is your indication of doing that? What Gopi was telling?
Mostly posterior on tears, posterior and middle third of the tears. Usually I use that, sir.
Anmay, do you use that regularly? How you?
Yeah,
do that?
I for root tears and the you're talking about the scorpion for root tears and for horizontal cleavage tears with a with small cyst when we decompress, then after usually for that perimeniscal cyst also when we're doing it arthroscopically, it's mostly associated with the horizontal cleavage tears. So I close the horizontal cleavage after that. Using yes, this
because I know Rajiv is using that. That's why
I usually do that.
It's self-retrieving, very good self-retrieving, and you can go for all inside bucket handle repair also with the same. Just you have to just cut the needle, take the 20 suture, and you can go all inside bucket handle repair. Very cost effective.
It's also very good for a radial tear repair.
Yeah, exactly.
You can take bite from side to side and do a radial tear repair because there is no other way to do a radial tear repair other than using a good scorpion.
Yeah. Yeah. Very true.
Another one, the question to IPS.
Yeah.
There is also we know that the your all inside technique there are two bullets inside. Okay. So in some company they are having 5-7 bullets. Do you ever use that or what is your opinion on that?
No, I have not used that. I think Linvatech has got one where you can actually put my understand very well, and I think very nicely was shown by Sachin. If you stitch a meniscus. Once the meniscus tends to evert, and you need to actually do sequential tightening separately. So I would rather prefer to do one and then go to another and then go to another, so that I am able to reduce the meniscus more anatomically. Yes. If you are just doing 1, 2, 3 and then finally tightening it, it is usually not a good idea because meniscus may either stand up or may start to roll down. So there are experts, probably they are using it with the instrument where you can take 5, 6, 7 stitches at a single go. But I usually take an implant, which is one and then another one for the second.
Two bullets. My question bullets. To madam, one question to madam. Madam, just you for the viewers, you tell me the ideal time of doing a repeat MR or the best time of doing a repeat MR for meniscal healing, when you can confidently tell, okay, it has healed or it has not been healed, it is not going to heal. Unmute.
2 years.
2 years, okay. So this is a good point. So not that every 6 months you do your MRI and just this is a totally burden for the, because the MRI, with even with the 3 machine, they cannot comment on. So the message to all the viewers is that is it 2 years time when you can go with the MR, don't go like 6 months.
I want to say that if you think symptomatically patient has some instability,
then
in around 5 months, 6 months, then you have to do it and see that repair has failed or not.
Yes, definitely. That is a different story because clinically. Yeah.
But if it is asymptomatic, then just to evaluate a healing, minimum 2 years. So if it's symptomatic, you have to do it in between and just be sure that it is not healed.
What helps is to compare it with the preoperative MRI. You look at the configuration of the tear on the pre-op, you figure out what surgery has been done, and then you look at the post-op MR to see, you know, whether it's okay, not okay. So
sometime a fresh tear has happened in rehabilitation phase.
Correct.
Patient would actually blame you, and that is why a rural radiologist is important, that they can compare the older tear with a healing and a fresh tear which has happened. And with
there are a lot of
repairs which are going to happen now in last 2-3 years, and MRI being done rampantly, lot of litigation will start coming back because patient would think that you are not repaired, you have used all the implants and you are still not repaired the tear.
Yes, Gopi is going to comment. Gopi.
I have a question to Dr. Samantha.
Yes.
What about the newer techniques like PRP, stem cell, fibrin cloth? Will they help in meniscal healing?
No, that helps in literature. That doesn't help in actual scenario.
If you are doing it with ACL already, the fibrin cloth will go there.
Yeah.
If you are doing ACL, if a blood pump tunnel will go there in meniscal capsule junction only.
Because this is like the PRP. Is it plus minus?
What about repigmentation, microfracture? Do they help?
Yes, that helps. We never draw the blood, make it clot, and put the clot inside. That is theoretically, and in video, in humidity, that looks good, but that probably doesn't work in my hand.
But if you're doing an isolated meniscus repair, you should go ahead and do microfracture.
Yes, and I'm completely agreeing. But he was asking on the fibrin clot.
No, fibrin clot is your own individual decision. Fibrin clot will work if you're putting the fibrin clot before the repair in between the tissue. After repair, you can't insert fibrin clot inside. So you have to be technically very sound to put a fibrin clot, reduce, and then repair it. It usually comes out.
That's why this doesn't work in my hand.
Question to Dr. Gopi. Question to Dr. Gopi. Hello.
Yes.
Question to Dr. Gopi. When you are going for a meniscal repair with all inside devices, and your two of your devices misfires, so how you bail out? And how you deal with the financial implication with misfiring of two of your all inside devices with two costly implants?
Before Gopi answers this question, I give a small trick to Gopi, because two bullets are misfired. So immediately I know that I am not going to get something at the end of the surgery. So now Gopi, you go ahead.
So that's what I mentioned during my presentation. Not only that you will lose on financial aspect, you are unnecessarily introducing a plastic chip into the knee joint. So if one misfires, never try for a second. And definitely you are going to lose the surgeon's fee. It is sure. So you have to do surgeon's fee of course, because hospital is not going to provide. So in that instance, I think if you have a knee socket in the hand and a fiber wire, it will really help you. You can just put one bite on the other side, the other on this side. Anyway, one is misfired, you can get away with the knee part. So we always keep this instrument in our tray.
Another one question. Point I want to ask Ranjit, once two are misfired in my hand, there I take a deep breath and make sure that another one is not misfired.
The question to Dr. IPS.
Yeah, Ranjit.
How you deal with the meniscal, lateral meniscal tears around the popliteal? Popliteal hiatus. So I think ever have to take the bite through the popliteus?
No, never. So it has in front and in the back. And lateral meniscus is more mobile meniscus. It's more forgiving meniscus.
Right.
So all you need to do is just stitch it in front and in back, and you just leave it like that. It is going to heal. If it is in a healing vascular zone.
Ranjit, I have got a question to you.
Sir.
Before the start of the meeting, you and Bilal has told us that there are three sessions of meniscus. One is basic, one is middle, and one is advanced.
So please
tell me what is about the middle one and what is the advanced one.
Generally,
I will come and join.
Sir, the advanced one is root, ramp, and meniscal transplant. Okay. And the third one is case-based discussion.
Okay, that is good. I'm telling in a lighter mode. I know that. I know that mode.
So I think it's around 9 o'clock now. It's already 2 hours now.
Sir, I just want to ask one question.
Yeah.
So to IPS, sir.
Yeah.
Like regard the bucket handle tears, have you ever gone back and done a redo surgery for bucket handle tears?
Yes.
So what's your experience? They have healed well or?
No. It's
what is the percentage?
Partially healed. So
the
cases when we have to go in and see, they are partially healed, and you have to excise the part which is not healed. You don't usually try and attempt it second time, because if the success rate in first time was not close to 70-80%, second time it would be even lesser than that, and patient would not agree for a third surgery then. So yes, we had to undergo a second arthroscopy for a bucket handle tear. It showed partial healing. Whatever has healed, it is good, because we saved that meniscus. Whatever is not healed, we excise it. We don't try to do it second time. That's my practice. I think Indian patients are not going to accept a third surgery after that.
Yeah.
But at least they are now started to understand that you are trying to save a meniscus, and if at all it fails, partially even if it heals, it is good. It still protects the joint from weight bearing.
Yes. One more thing, sir.
Okay, Sridhar.
Yeah, nothing. So you're told that there is some healing within the repaired bucket handle. Like.
Yeah.
So can you specify it's in the anterior aspect, posterior or middle?
No, it's usually
from your experience.
It is between anterior and the posterior. Central part doesn't heal.
The central
part. Because actually loads happen, central part doesn't heal. It's a healing in the front and in the back. So we trim it and make it
shave it off the second, shape it off, center part.
Yeah.
So we have got just two hour we have completed. So I will request Sandeep and Ranjit to conclude the meeting.
Sir, it was a nice meeting covering all the aspects of basics of the meniscus. The talk by Dr. Anupama Patil was really excellent, elaborating all the aspects of imaging of the meniscus. And the doctor talk by Dr. IPS was really good. And he really covered all the basic principles of the meniscal repair. And then Sachin, he had covered all the techniques, the basics of the techniques, and how you do a good meniscal repair by all inside technique, inside out, outside in technique. And the tips and tricks were nicely demonstrated. And then by Dr. Gopi, how after knowing all these, how you will prepare inside the OT. So that is the most crucial part. And Dr. Gopi had covered nicely. And after that, we had a very nice discussion. And the concluding remark are yet to come by Dr. IPS.
So I must thank all the members of Executive Committee of Indian Arthroscopy Society to organize such webinars. The importance of webinar is live transmission and also archiving of these webinars on the website and IES YouTube channel. What is important for those who are unable to see it today can see it later. It is making a very good educational material for all of us. There are certain points in meetings which we attend. We think, we hear, but it just goes out of our mind. But now these meetings are recorded and they are put on the public platform. These discussions help us in revisiting all our queries which were happening. In the times of COVID, we are all stuck in homes. But these kind of discussions would keep our brain still working and we don't become Alzheimer's. So I'll take a call and thank you very much. It was a wonderful meeting. If I can request Sandeep to put the next meeting logo right here, because
fire teaching
can have a